Good afternoon. So now we will be talking about infection control practices in the context of COVID-19. So as we have all seen that COVID-19 is caused by an infection by the virus that is known as the SARS-CoV-2 virus. The virus spreads predominantly by respiratory route, by respiratory droplets, as well as by direct contact with fumites such as surfaces. Virus can survive on surfaces for around 3 days. But it can also be viable in aerosols for up to few hours. So our infection control measures should be tailored according to what a virus can survive. So if you see this slide, there we see that this study which was published in NEJM, it has shown that virus can survive on aerosols, copper surfaces, cardboard, stainless steel, as well as plastics. So virus can remain viable and infectious in aerosols for a few hours and on surfaces such as cardboard and copper for up to days. So what are the specific areas where we have to see regarding the prevention of infection? So first of all, we look at the triage. Triage is the area where patients are screened for respiratory symptoms such as fever, cough and shortness of breath before they enter the healthcare facility. Your entire nose and mouth are sealed with the N95 mask. After wearing N95 mask, you are supposed to wear the eye covers. Eye cover can be form of goggles or it can be in form of a face shield which is made of plastic and does not allow any secretions to come in contact with the face or eye. After wearing the eye shield, we wear a hood. Hood means it's a equipment which we have to wear and then we have to tie it around our neck. And then we wear the second pair of gloves. After we have been able to do all this, there should be somebody around us who should see that no parts of our body is exposed and can become a contamination source. So that's how it takes around 5 to 10 minutes to wear the entire PPE. It should be done slowly and in all the steps should be followed rather than skipping the steps. So then once you have finishing your shift, you have to do doffing of PPE, that is removal of the PPE. Removal of PPE is extremely important, even more important than how you wear it. Because once you finish your duty in an infected area, you will be wearing the equipment which are infected. So you should not be aerosolizing it and spreading the infection. So first of all, you reach the doffing area and then you disinfect your hands with the alcohol-based drops. After disinfecting, you sit and then you remove your shoe covers, touching the outer surface and perform the hand hygiene. After you remove the outer gloves, you perform hand hygiene, then you remove your hood. After removing your hood as well as neck cover, you perform hand hygiene. So it is important that after removal of each part of your PPE, you have to perform hand hygiene. After removing the hood, you remove gown. Gown should be removed very carefully. So while removing gown, hood and eyepiece, you should be bending forward and you should remove them very slowly so that you prevent the aerosolization of the secretions which may be lying over your gown or mask or hood. After that, you remove the gloves. Then you wear another pair of gloves and after wearing another pair of gloves, you remove the N95 mask. N95 mask, you should never touch the front surface. It should always be held from the strips. So first of all, you remove the lower strip and followed by the upper strip. This procedure should also be done bending forward so that it prevents the aerosolization. And in the end, you perform hand hygiene, clean your shoes with alcohol swabs and remove the last pair of gloves and then perform hand hygiene. So performing hand hygiene is essential component of doffing as well. So if you see, there are multiple steps while you're removing your PPEs. So you always need somebody else around you so that he can see that you are doing it correctly and you are not skipping any steps. It is ideal that if you have an auto dispenser for alcohol based hand rubs, it becomes easier for you to do the hand rub rather than a buddy providing you the alcohol based hand rubs. So these are the two important aspects of infection control, that how do you wear and remove the personal protective equipment. So now we come to the patient placement and type of isolation. So we can have infections which can be coming in contact or by droplet or by airborne. Right now, current understanding is that COVID-19 spreads by droplets, and these patients should be provided with a private room, and masks should be worn during care as well as transport of these patients. So what are the WHO recommendations for COVID-19? WHO suggests that standard contact as well as droplet precautions, that is gown, gloves and masks with an eye or face protection should be used. The mask given by WHO can be triple layer surgical mask or an N95 mask. N95 mask essentially should be worn during airborne precautions such as the aerosol generating procedures, intubation, bag and mask ventilation prior to intubation, tracheostomy, non-invasive ventilation, bronchoscopy and CPR. During all these procedures, you should be essentially wearing a N95 mask rather than a triple layer surgical mask. According to CDC recommendation, patients who are suspected or confirmed with COVID-19 should be kept in a single occupancy room with a closed door and dedicated bathroom. The patient should wear a face mask if he is being transported out of the room. An airborne infection isolation room, that is a negative pressure room, should be used for patients who are undergoing aerosol generating procedures such as intubation, NIV application or bronchoscopy. Healthcare personnel who are entering the room of patients with suspected or confirmed COVID-19 should wear the appropriate PPE, which includes gown, gloves, eye protection and a respirator. If supply of respirators is considered limited, face masks, that is triple layer surgical masks, are an acceptable alternative. So what are the guidance for using PPE in different settings? That is, in what areas of hospital, which PPE you should be wearing? So first of all, we go into the patient room. In patient room, and healthcare personnel who is providing direct care to COVID-19 patients should wear all four, that is mask, gown, gloves, as well as eye protection. If a patient is undergoing an aerosol generating procedure, the healthcare personnel should be wearing an N95 respirator. The cleaners, room cleaners who enter the patient room, they should be wearing all four things, but they should be wearing heavy duty gloves as well as boots so that they are not exposed to splash of the contaminated material. And visitors who visit the patient room, they should be wearing medical mask, gown as well as gloves. In the triage area, that is where patients are coming for screening, healthcare personnel who is not coming in direct contact, that is if you can maintain a distance of more than 1 meter with the patient, then healthcare personnel need to wear only a medical mask. So this is the guideline which we are following, but Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has suggested that at this place also N95 mask can be used if available. If N95 respirators are not available, medical mask can be used. Patients who are coming with any respiratory symptoms, we should be maintaining a distance of at least 1 meter and wear a medical mask. Patients who come to triage without any respiratory symptoms, use of no PPE is required. For lab workers who are handling respiratory secretions, they should be wearing all four components of the PPE. Now coming to the consultation room. In the consultation room, if you are examining a patient's respiratory symptom, you should be wearing all four components of PPE. If you are examining patients without respiratory symptoms, you can wear PPE depending upon the standard risk. But without respiratory symptoms, you are not required to wear all four components of the PPE. But if patients have any respiratory symptom, you should be wearing at least a medical mask during history taking. But during examination, you should be taking all four components. The cleaners who are entering the consultation room after and between consultations with the patient with respiratory symptoms should be wearing all components of medical mask, including heavy duty gloves. Now we come to the environmental disinfection in the hospital. So in the hospital, the important thing is surface cleaning and toilet cleaning. Surface cleaning, patient care equipment and non-easy accessible places of cot can be cleaned with Bacillol spray, which is ethanol based spray, and contact period is 5 minutes. So in ICU and in general patient areas, surface cleaning can be done with Bacillol with 5 minutes contact period. Toilet cleaning should be done with 7% Lysol and contact period should be 10 minutes. And for hand rub purposes, we should be using an alcohol based hand rub. Then we have hypochlorite solution. Hypochlorite solution is available in different strengths which can be prepared at that time. 1%, 10% and 0.1%. 1% hypochlorite solution should be used for cleaning of ventilator circuits, oxygen masks, nasal prong, suction jar and tubes, blood and bloody fluid stain instruments and linen, and contact time should be 15 minutes. 10% hypochlorite solution is only used to decontaminate the large blood spill more than 10 ml, and the contact period is 15 minutes. Dilute hypochlorite solution, that is 0.1%, is used to clean infected patient bed in isolation room, and contact time should be 10 minutes. And for general hospital floor cleaning, detergent and soap can be used. Now coming to the patient placement and transportation. For shifting any suspected patients, the following steps must be followed. That means you decontaminate your hands, you wear your PPE, you inform the doctor or the staff at destination regarding transfer of a potentially infectious patient. In the ambulance, use of single-use linen and medical equipment should be done wherever possible. That means you should be using single-use rather than reusable linen or equipment. And cleaning and disinfecting of ambulance should be done prior to next use while you are wearing the PPEs. Now we come to an important aspect of healthcare personnel with potential exposure and how do we manage these people. Healthcare personnel refers to all paid as well as non-paid persons who are serving in healthcare settings who have the potential for direct or indirect exposure to patient or infectious material. What do we call as close contact? Close contact is defined as if you are within approximately 2 meters of a person with COVID-19 for a prolonged period of time, that is caring for a patient, or having unprotected direct contact with infectious secretions or excretions of the patient. For example, being coughed on, touching used tissues with a bare hand. How do we manage these patients? So here we have to see, if you have a prolonged close contact with a COVID-19 patient who was wearing a face mask, that means patient, you are looking at a patient and patient is wearing a face mask. So how do we manage the healthcare workers who come in contact with such a patient? So if healthcare worker was wearing all the PPEs, there is no exclusion from any duties required. If healthcare worker was not wearing any PPE, including masks, he should be excluded from work for at least 14 days after the exposure. If healthcare worker was not wearing a face mask or a respirator, he should be excluded from work for 14 days after the exposure. If healthcare worker was wearing all PPE except the eye protection, then no exclusion from work is required. Not wearing gown, gloves, even then you don't need to be excluded from work. So what is the most important component is the face mask. So if you are wearing a face mask, then you do not need to be excluded. But what is required from your side is that you should perform self-monitoring with oversight by a healthcare facility, occupational health or infection control program. That means you have come in contact, you can continue to work in the hospital, but you should keep a monitoring on your symptoms. Now we come to the person, healthcare worker, who has come in prolonged close contact with a COVID-19 patient who was not wearing a face mask. That means patient was not wearing a mask and now you have come in contact with the patient. If you are also not wearing any of the PPE, then you should be excluded from work for at least 14 days after last exposure. If you are wearing all the PPEs but you were not wearing a face mask, then you should be excluded from work for 14 days. If you are wearing all except the eye protection, even then you should be excluded for 14 days from the work. So this is different from when patient was wearing mask. If patient was not wearing mask, then infection into your eyes can also be transmitted. So that means you should be excluded from work if you have been exposed to a patient without wearing a eye shield. If you were not wearing a gown or gloves, in that case, you should do not need to be excluded from work, but you need to keep check of your symptoms. So to conclude, in regarding infection control practices, basic rules remain same, that is standard precautions are the most essential. Hand hygiene is crucial to break the chain of transmission. Triple layer surgical mask with other PPEs for ICUs and critical care. Standard sanitization practice for various hospital areas. And healthcare personnel management depends upon the type of exposure.